Today is April 26, 1998. Mark Sternlicht is being interviewed in Stamford, Connecticut, USA, in English by me, Betsy Stern. Mr. Sternlicht, let's begin with your telling us when you were born.
I was born on December 9th, 1929.
And that makes you, at the present time,
depending on the definition, either 68 or 69, because I was born in December.
And where were you born?
In Kraków, Poland.
What are the names of your parents?
Jacob, my father, and Lola, my mother.
And what was your mother's maiden name?
Kellerman.
Could you spell that for us?
K-L-L-E-R-M-A-N.
And did you have any brothers or sisters?
I have one sister. Her name is Selina. C-E-L-I-N-A.
And when was she born?
She was born on July 3rd, 1934.
And when you were born, your family lived?
In Krakow.
What do you remember about the house you lived in?
It was an apartment. It was in a high-rise. We were, I believe, on a second floor. It was a comfortable apartment. I had my own room, and we had, I believe, a bedroom, a dining room, a kitchen, a servant's room.
You remember servants in the house?
Yes. We had a cook and a governess.
What did your father do?
In Krakow, my father had a factory which manufactured paper bags.
Remember the name of the factory?
No.
Do you remember ever visiting the factory?
I used to visit it every day from school. On the way back from school, I used to stop in my father's factory, and he would give me a small coin, and I would then go to a stationery store and buy some things to do.
And then did you go on home?
Home, right.
Did your mother work?
No. My mother was at home.
Was your family observant?
Yes. Modern Orthodox.
Do you remember going to the synagogue?
Yes, with my father.
How often was that?
Every Saturday.
Did your family observe all the holidays as well?
Yes.
What was your favorite holiday?
Probably Passover. Because it was completely different. And I would get presents.
You got presents?
Yeah.
What do you remember especially besides the presents about Passover?
Well, it was a big, big meal. And my father conducted a Seder. And it was usually some members of the family were also present. It was very nice.
Did your mother light candles?
Yes, every Friday. And we had a Friday dinner. My father used to come home for dinner from the factory. And but the big meal in Europe in those days was lunch. And but Friday night we had a Friday night dinner.
What do you remember that your mother that was specially made for Friday night?
Fish. Fish. My mother made very special fish.
What kind of fish was special?
Carp. And not gefilte fish. I did not eat gefilte fish until I came to America. But it was carp, and it was sweet, and was very good. Used to eat it with challah, and dip the challah in the sauce. It was very good.
Do you have other favorite foods?
I think I was what was called a good eater. I would eat well. You can see that habit has continued.
When did you start school?
I started school at the usual age, and I went to a day school. At that time in Krakow, there was they call it a Hebrew school, and that's where I went.
And what do you remember studying in that school?
Well, I remember having secular subjects in Hebrew. I studied I did a lot of, I loved as a child reading fairy tales. And I remember that I used to get very interested in tales in Hebrew. But yeah, I was very young. I went into first grade.
Were the names of any of those fairy tales?
I used to love all of the Gulliver's tales and Hans Christian Andersen, translated into Polish. An interesting thing about that school is that we had to wear uniforms. And in Europe, uniform included a cap, and a cap had a color piping around the head, and we wore a blue piping on a navy cap, which was basically saying to the street urchins that I was Jewish, because ours was the only school that had that color. And that was pretty disturbing, because we would get routinely beaten or chased.
This was all in the early years?
This was during Poland's independence. It was well before the war.
Did you have any playmates who were not Jewish?
I don't think so.
Do you know if the neighborhood you lived in was a Jewish neighborhood?
It was not. We did not live in the traditional Jewish neighborhood in Kraków, which is called Kazimierz.
So that, although there were a lot of children who weren't Jewish, you had very little to do with them?
I don't recall having a friend who was not Jewish. I had cousins, and we had many cousins that we played with.
And those were the children that you spent most time with?
Right.
What games did you like to play?
I like to play soccer. And I had a scooter. My parents bought me a scooter. I loved that scooter. I used to be an absolute demon on it. Yeah.
At your school, were there organized sports?
I don't believe so. Not at all. We had gym. I know that. And I like gym very much.
Do you remember the name of your school?
It was called Hebrajskie Gymnasium. And it was on a Brzozowa Street.
Do you remember when things started to change in Poland and Krakow?
In what way?
Were you aware, or did your parents talk about what was happening in Germany?
Yes. Yes, they did. And I remember reading posters that Poland was preparing for a war, and there was a very, very nationalistic spirit. There were posters which said Poland is strong, Poland is alert, and Poland is ready. And there was a lot of military parades, mostly cavalry, horse soldiers. And of course there was the era of Piłsudski died, and he was replaced by a gentleman by the name of Rydz Śmigły, who was a rabid anti-Semite. Piłsudski was probably a more tolerant anti-Semite. And I remember my father, the town had built a memorial to Piłsudski. People actually carried earth and built a mountain with a spiral walk. I remember my father took me there, and we put some earth on that mountain in Krakow.
And when Piłsudski died and the government was taken over by somebody else, do you remember changes in the way?
Well, you know, Poland was always had restrictive policies with respect to Jews. So you always had led a life of a second-class citizen. And I think it became a little bit more open and more virulent, but it was never anything but anti-Semitic.
When you were a little boy, were you aware that you were a second-class citizen?
Oh, yes.
In what ways?
Well, I used to get beaten up. They used to take my lunch. I had one of these little leather cases that my mother packed my lunch, and as soon as I left the house, they would wait for me and take my lunch and give me a few kicks. I got to the habit of running. I was very fast. I was a very good runner. If you can't fight, you have to learn how to run. And I used to stop somebody, an adult on the street, and I would say, please help me, because they're trying to beat me up, and people usually would.
Help you?
Yeah.
How would they help you? What would they do?
Just by being near me, the other kids would sort of, you know, fade into the background.
Did your parents know what was going on?
Yes, and my mother started coming to school for me and taking me to school in the morning.
Were there any other Jewish children who lived in your neighborhood?
Yeah, my cousins.
And they?
The same. It was not different. I was not being singled out. It was the same for everybody.
Did the teachers in the school talk about it at all?
I don't remember. No. It was such an accepted fact of life. You know, it didn't make any headlines. Headlines would have been made had it not been like that.
Did your father ever talk about encountering anti-Semitism in his business?
No, but I remember my father once slapping a man and actually decking him because he called my father a dirty Jew. And this was during a walk on a Saturday afternoon in Krakow.
What did your father explain to you about that afterwards?
My father was a very, very strict father. And it was just another lesson, is don't fool around with your father. Yeah, no, he said, you know, he called me something I didn't. He wouldn't repeat what the man called him. And he said, I just taught him a lesson. He won't call me that again.
Was your father then not afraid of any authorities, do you think?
I never saw my father afraid. He was very, very civil. He had beautiful manners and very courteous, but very outspoken. Very outspoken. He would speak his mind.
When your family talked before 1939, did they talk about what was happening to the Jews in Germany?
Not in front of me. Not that I would, not that I remember.
When did you notice things starting to really change for you and your family?
When we were asked. The first sign that things were changing was when we took in a German Jewish refugee.
And when was that?
It was in probably 1938, because the Germans had expelled the German Jews and sent them, some who could went west, and those who had no place to go, they just put in a train and went east, and the Jewish community asked Jewish people to accept refugees, and we took in a woman. Her name was Mrs. Meyer, Frau Meyer. And she came to live with us. And she would tell us stories about what was going on in Germany, but interestingly, she would defend Hitler.
How would she do that?
She would say that this was necessary to get rid of some undesirable elements. But she was certain she would go back to Germany, because her husband, who by that time was dead, was an officer of the German army, was decorated with the Iron Cross in the First War, and she knew she was going back.
Do you remember where she was from in Germany?
I think she was from Berlin. She came. She had nothing. They took her on a train in her nightclothes, and she took with her a coffee mug. And the coffee mug, I remember, had an inscription on it, which said in German, Mein Gott in Himmel, wie schön ist die Welt, man braucht bloß Kaffee und ein bisschen Geld. Do you understand what that means?
A little. Can you translate
My
that for
God
us?
God in heaven, how wonderful the world is. All you need is coffee and a little bit of money. I remember I was fascinated by that coffee pot. That was her only belonging that she came with.
And what happened to her? How long did she stay with you?
She stayed with us for maybe 6-7 months, and I think then the Jewish community put her someplace else. She left us.
Did she tell you stories that frightened you in any way?
No. She was an elderly lady, very kind, very grandmotherly. She was not like she would live in a dream world. She thought that this was temporary, this would pass away, and she will be back to her life in Germany. She had also a slight disregard of the Eastern Jew, you know, which was very prevalent in Germany.
And what else did you see changing?
The change, it was very gradual, very hard to quantify, so that the demarcation was really when a war broke out.
Do you remember that?
Yeah. I remember reading in a paper that the war broke out. And prior to the war, prior to the actual date of the war breaking out, the radio propaganda started broadcasting horror stories about what the Germans would do if they invaded Poland. Not specifically against Jews, because they couldn't care less if the Germans did something to the Jews, but what they would do to able-bodied men and women, and men particularly. So I remember that. And I think it was in school was out.
And then in August of 39, September of 39, did you see troops, German troops, Polish troops?
Well, what happened is, prodded by this propaganda, my father left us because they said that if they found a person who was a civilian, they would kill him. So my father went on a road. There were millions of people, maybe not millions, but thousands of people, just on the roads going someplace. My father left us and went to where my grandparents on my mother's side lived, which was a town called Sanok. So he left us in 1939, in September, and we never saw him again until 1946.
Did you understand why he was leaving?
He said goodbye to me. He said, I have to leave. I gave him a little notebook with a little letter that I wrote to him, which, by the way, I have. I know where it is. And he came back. He had this little with him. I didn't understand why he left. He left dressed in a, he was a very neatly dressed man. He left in a beautiful top coat, a pair of street shoes, a beautiful suit, and his briefcase, because he thought he was coming back.
What did your mother say about it all?
I don't know what she said to him. She didn't say much to us. She said, Father will be back. Father's leaving, he'll be back.
And then what happened to his business?
Well, then I remember waking up at night and the window panes were shaking in a house. And I had never heard window panes shaking. And I never heard that type of a noise. And when I woke up in the morning, there were German military cars and vehicles parked all along the streets of probably every street in Krakow. I had never seen so many cars and so many trucks. And the Germans had just rolled into town. There was very limited resistance in Krakow. I think whatever fighting was done on the outskirts. And that's when I first saw the Germans.
How did they look to you?
this was the army, and the army looked friendly. They were very strong looking, beautifully equipped soldiers. I remember them washing in a town fountain, and they looked very, very strong, and they were not overtly hostile, at least not to the civilian population. Then they were followed by the troops which stayed to administer the conquered territories, and they were the ones who started the anti-Jewish laws.
Were you aware of the difference?
We had, because we had a nice apartment, we were told that we will have to take somebody to live in with us, and we got a German officer living with us. But he was an army officer. And he's the one who started telling my mother to do everything she can to save herself, because this is not going to be good for Jews. This was very early, before they started with the truly terrible, you know, persecution.
Did you hear him telling your mother that?
I spoke German, and I didn't speak German that well, but my mother told me. He used to play with me. And when he went home on leave to his family, he came back and bought me some German mechanical cars, German toys. I remember the name. Schuko was the manufacturer.
Do you remember his name?
No. No. And then he was shipped out, and he told my mother to please save yourself.
How long did he live with you?
Maybe 6 months, 5 months.
Was your mother making any plans that you knew about?
Well, my mother tried to, I'll go back to my father's business. My business was, my old Jewish businesses were given non-Jew owners, supervisors, used to call it Treuhandlung. So they took the business away from us, and they appointed this non-Jew who my mother knew. And he was sort of running our business for us, and my mother tried to get some money out of that. And I think she was able to get some money out of it, but it was every day there was a new decree. You have to turn in all your silver. You have to turn in all your gold. All the radios. You know, you cannot go. I remember you cannot go on a certain street. You cannot go shopping on a certain time. It was a constant stream of new laws designed to oppress the Jewish population, and they were administered through a Jewish organization which the Germans had set up, which was run by Jews.
Did you know any of those Jews who were running the organization?
No. I was nine.
Did your mother know anybody?
Probably. My uncle probably knew them. My uncle came back. My uncle also left at the same time my father left, but he turned around and came back.
Now, what was this uncle's name?
Silber, Leo Silber.
And he was your mother's...
He was married to my father's sister.
Married to your father's sister. And did they also live in Krakow?
Yes.
Near you?
Yes, well, within Krakow was within walking distance any place.
Do you remember the adults in your family, your uncle, your mother making...
I remember the ones that lived near us and that interacted with the family. My father was one of 13 children. And so I don't remember all of them, but I remember the ones that lived in Krakow. He had two brothers and two sisters living in Krakow.
Did the family get together to try to make plans during this time? When your uncle came back?
I think my uncle Silber and us, yes. The others, I think, had their own plans.
Were you aware of their making plans at that point?
No.
Had school, what was happening with school?
School was out. School that never reopened after the Germans occupied Krakow.
What did you do to keep busy?
Read. I tried to get a bicycle, and I was very busy trying to arrange for me to be able to have a bicycle. But basically, you know, didn't have the kind of distractions and kind of amusements that we have today.
Did you have to help your mother in any kind of way at that point?
Well, we always had to help, but I don't remember anything specific or any adult tasks. You know, I was still treated as a child.
Was money a problem for your mother?
No.
Had your father left her with money?
We had money. My father was, we were comfortable. And
your mother had access to that money as far as
you
knew?
Well, you know, my mother had, we had some jewelry and some gold, and I think my mother had access to that.
We've come to the end of this tape. Mr. Sternlicht, you were telling us about the assets that your family had that you knew about.
Yeah, we had money, and I think it's really what saved our lives. That money and my uncle's ingenuity and intelligence and resourcefulness.
What did your family decide to do, and when did they decide to do it?
Well, the Germans made a lot of decisions for us. We had to leave Krakow. We were expelled from our apartment.
How did that happen?
Just a decree. By a certain time, all the Jews had to leave Krakow.
How were these decrees made known?
I don't know. I think there were posted posters, because we could not listen to radio, so it could not have been broadcast. But it was a fairly cohesive community, so it wasn't that difficult. They would post posters, plaster them all over the town, so it was next to impossible. It was impossible not to see them. In Krakow, they had these kiosks where they would post all of the announcements. In the good old days, they would post movies and theatrical performances, and during the war, they would post all of the decrees against the Jews.
Do you remember that when this was that you had to leave your home?
I think it was in 43, maybe. No, I don't remember. I don't remember the exact date.
Had the ghetto been set up yet?
No, this was before.
So then what did your family do when the decree came?
We left and we went to a town called Wieliczka. And we settled on a little farm where we rented some rooms.
Who had made those plans?
My uncle. My uncle arranged for that, and he was still in Krakow.
And who went with you to the farm?
My mother, my sister, my grandmother, my father's mother.
And her name?
Rachel.
And her last name was
Sternlicht.
And what was the farm like?
It was very pleasant. We had a nice big garden. We had a nice room. One room and a kitchen. Yeah, bedroom and a kitchen. And I remember it was a summer. I used to go through the fields, and I used to, you know, lay in the grass, and it was very pleasant. It was not difficult at all.
Did you have any socialize at all with the farm family?
I think there were some non-Jewish farm boys that I became sort of friendly with. They would teach me about horses and animals.
Did you help with the animals on the farm?
I helped with the horses. I did not like milking cows.
What did your mother do there?
I don't think she did anything. She just took care of us and took care of my grandmother.
Who did the cooking?
Both of them, mostly my mother.
And where did they get food from? Do you know?
From the farmer's market, from the farmers and from the market. Food was not, there was no shortage of food.
Do you remember whether you could come and go easily from the farm? Did you have special instructions from your mother?
I think we could move about fairly freely. I don't recall going anywhere, anything meaningful. We sort of stayed around, and I don't even recall going into town too often, although I think I did go into town.
Did your uncle come to visit?
Yes. He would come to visit.
Did you hear from your father at all at that point?
No. No, we didn't know where he was. And we did not hear from my mother's parents either. So we didn't know where they were.
Did you have any news of what was happening to the Jews who had stayed in Krakow?
Not anything that I specifically remember.
How long were you on the farm?
Well, we were there until we were told to go back into the ghetto. And so that must have been probably the summer of 1940, and we went to the ghetto in March of 1941.
Did you observe any Jewish holidays while you were on the farm?
I think we always tried to observe the holidays to some degree. We would not eat non-kosher meat. And we would try to live the life the way we used to live it. So I don't recall us breaking with the tradition.
What was the news that you had to go back into the ghetto? How did you get that news?
Again, there was general communication that the ghetto has been established in Krakow, and all the Jews living within a certain radius of Krakow had to report to the ghetto, or if they were found, they would be shot. So I remember, again, thousands of people walking or riding on horse-driven carriages and going back to the area of the ghetto.
How much time do you remember that you were given to get back into the ghetto, to get back to Krakow?
I don't remember, but it was not a leisurely schedule. When in a ghetto, then we were joined by my uncle.
How were you feeling about all this?
I had no frame of reference. You know, it's when you live with oppression as a fact of life, all of your life, you have no frame of reference. You know, you have no way of saying, why is this happening to me? That's the way it was. And so I coped with it. I imagine I coped with it well, because I was very pliant.
Do you remember feeling that your mother, your grandmother, was upset, worried?
My mother was worried. My grandmother was worried. But my mother had very, very, very high spirits. My mother had a tremendous spirit. It was hard to get my mother down in those days. She was strong. She was very directive. She would. She was no pushover.
When all these people were returning to Krakow and being told to go into the ghetto, do you remember what that was like? What happened when you got into Krakow?
My uncle had arranged for a place for us to live in a ghetto. We had a two-room apartment in a house without toilet. The toilet was in a yard, one for the whole building. And we had two rooms, and into those two rooms, one of those rooms was a kitchen. We were my uncle, his wife, and my cousin, that's three, the four of us, my uncle's sister and her son. So that's now 7, 8, 9. And then somebody from the ghetto came and said we had to take in another man. So there were 10 people in two rooms.
Could you give us the names of your uncle's wife and your cousin and the
My uncle's wife was, her name was Hebrew, her English first name was Eve, but everybody called her diminutive, Efja. And my cousin's name was Halina, H-A-L-I-N-A. She's alive, and her name is now Helen.
And the other family?
Siedner.
Could you spell that?
S-I-E-D-N-E-R.
And the first names of that?
Sala. And I guess he called himself Monyush, M-O-N-I-U-S-Z, was her son. And the man who was asked to live with us, I just found this out by talking to my cousin because I did not remember, his name was Rapp, R-A-P-P.
What was it like for you living like that?
It was crowded. You wanted to spend as little time as possible indoors. I don't know if my uncle arranged it or if I was forced to, but I started working. I started working in a German, in a factory which, in the ghetto, which produced brushes for the German army. Brushes to, to comb your hair, and also these cylindrical brushes to clean rifle
What was your job?
I actually made the brushes. I had to drill. They didn't have any division of work. I had to drill the wood on a drill press. I had to take a little bit of a pig's bristle, take a piece of wire, and twist it around the center of the bristles, and then pull that through the hole that I had drilled so that the bristles would fold and form one, and then trim and cut that. And I was making brushes.
Had you ever done any work like that before?
Never. Never. And my mother also worked. I don't know what she was doing, but she also worked. My sister did not.
And how did you eat?
I think the ladies cooked, and we had meals in shifts because you couldn't fit everybody around the table. So we ate. I don't recall starving. There was food. My uncle was very, very resourceful and very, very well thought of by the people and had access to very good information.
Now, how old were you when you were in the ghetto?
12. I was bar mitzvahed in the ghetto.
What was that like?
My mother insisted that I take Hebrew. I was taking Hebrew lessons in Wieliczka. She actually had a rabbinical student, or what we would call rabbinical student today, come to me and teach me Hebrew, and she continued that in a ghetto.
Do you remember the names of the people who taught you?
No. I remember what he looked like, but I can't remember his name. I did not like it. I did not like to study Hebrew. I found it very difficult. And then...
How often did this student come to you, and where did he teach you in such a crowded...
In Krakow, I went to the synagogue and studied there. Couldn't do it in where we lived. And I was prepared, more or less, enough to be bar mitzvahed on a Monday, which is, you read the Torah on Monday. And I remember going there. I remember people asking my mother, why are you doing this? Are you crazy? What is this going to accomplish? And she said, it's important that he do it. So I went to a very early morning service. My mother scraped together some cake and some whiskey. I did my bar mitzvah. I read the portion of the Torah that you're supposed to read for your bar mitzvah, and I went to work. And
there was a little party afterwards?
No.
Well, you said your mother scraped together.
Yeah, that was just for the members of the congregation. I don't remember anybody else coming.
Any family members come?
I don't remember. I don't remember. It was something that my mother wanted me to do, and it was important to her, and we did it. And I was given a pair of tefillin.
Who gave you the tefillin?
My mother. And I was taught how to put them on.
Did you put them on?
Yeah. I put them on all through the experience in Krakow. And then when we left, I didn't take them with me because they would be a dead giveaway that we were Jewish.
Were there other people in your apartment davening with the tefillin while you were?
No. Not that I remember. I used to do it in the morning alone, you know, not with the minion, just alone.
What was your work day like?
It was a long work day. I don't remember specifically the hours, but I used to leave very early in the morning. I would have a little lunch wrapped with me and come back. I came back. It was dark when I came back.
What was going on in the ghetto as you went back and forth to work? What do you remember seeing?
A lot of poverty, a lot of people begging. Every once in a while you would see somebody who died overnight. I left the ghetto twice. I just wanted to go out and see what was happening on the other side of the wall. And the ghetto was guarded by two pedestrian gates and a vehicular gate. The idea, the way you could leave the ghetto, if you got lucky, is you were waited until one of the pedestrian gates was unguarded. And then if a vehicular gate opened to let through a horse-driven carriage, you would walk alongside the carriage on the side that was not guarded, so the guard from the other side couldn't see you. That's how I left. And I remember once I left and came back without any problem, and the second time I left, I was caught by a Jewish, what they call them, Ordnungsdienst. And he did not arrest me, but he used the rubber truncheon and he whacked me on my butt, and I have never felt pain like that. I mean, I had, by the time I finally was able to take a look what he did to me, I had a welt that was black like coal, and I couldn't sit for days, and I couldn't tell anybody about it because my mother would be terribly upset. I don't know what I did on the other side of the ghetto. I don't think. I just wanted to see how people lived.
Do you remember seeing anything?
Yeah.
What did you see?
I knew Krakow. I knew the town. And I went to the places that I used to go. And I was amazed that life continued normally for them. There was, you know, they did not. You know, of course, that the ghetto, the Krakow ghetto, used to be traversed by a normal streetcar so that you could to go from one place to another, you would get on a streetcar, and the streetcar would enter the ghetto, the doors would close and would remain closed until it left the ghetto. But the windows were not rendered opaque, so people who took the streetcar could see people dying and begging and corpses laying. It was an everyday occurrence. Not once and not twice, the streetcars were running regularly. It was difficult to put in perspective that such a horror could be happening while life was going on, basically normal. The Poles did not, at least in everyday life, there was no Polish resistance to the German occupation. The Polish police worked with the Germans in rounding up Jews in enforcing all of the decrees against the Jews. There was no opposition to it. In many cases, the Germans did not know the characteristics of the Jews, you know, and the Polish police would point out people and say, he is Jewish. They were, their years of persecution taught them how to be much more knowledgeable about determining Jewish quote-unquote characteristics. I spoke Polish, excuse me, without a trace of a of an accent. I still do, and that was a big, big plus in those days, because Polish was my first language.
What else did you see in the ghetto in terms of people trying to survive? Did you see schools?
No. I think the whatever survival skills I saw had to do with people, you know, trying to make a better lot for themselves. People who would become Ordnungsdienst, you know, the Jewish policemen, people who would cater to them, people who would denounce people. It was that type of a survival skill, not anything that was organized to preserve the Jewish identity.
We've come to the end of this tape. We're still in the Krakow ghetto. When did your family start to talk about what was happening and what you should do next?
My uncle had access to some privileged information. He became, basically, I think it was done with money. And he was told that the ghetto would be liquidated. But it was not information that you could share with anybody, so that if he said something about it, it was at the time it was ready. We were ready to move. He was afraid, and it was imprudent to advertise that kind of information or to freely discuss it.
Do you have any idea who told him or where he got the information?
Probably the Jewish administration of the ghetto. He had very good contacts with these people. He also had a very good contact with the head of the Polish of the Jewish police, whom he bribed. So he manufactured a set of false papers which said that we were born in Buenos Aires. And the idea was that Germany was interested in maintaining neutrality with Argentina because they used Argentina as the refueling spot for their navy, and that we would, as such, we would have some kind of a protection. It was the kind of a idea which worked if everybody was willing to let it work. It would obviously would not stand up to any scrutiny. It was they were false papers. And I remember the man who did the papers worked in our house, and he was carving German stamps from erasers, actually hand carving the German eagle and a swastika and all the writing very skillfully, because the stamp looked absolutely original.
Do you remember his name?
No. And with the full complicity of the people who were at the gate, we left the night before the Germans liquidated the ghetto, the first liquidation.
Now, who is we?
Our family, my mother, my sister, my grandmother, and I.
And where did you go?
My uncle arranged for us to hide in a jail, in a Polish jail, because he felt that's the last place they'll be looking for Jews. So that's where we left.
And you went to a jail in?
Krakow. And we stayed, I think, 3 days in a cell while the ghetto was being liquidated. And then we left. And
who took care of you in the cell?
the jailer, I think he was paid to do so. And so we were given, you know, food and shelter and facilities and just stayed in jail.
Did you know what was happening in the ghetto, personally?
Yeah, because as we were leaving, the Germans were rolling in with the trucks. And so I knew something was going to happen. Because the Germans would have these periodic, you know, they call them razzia. They would just pull people off the street and ship them to a concentration camp. But this was big. This was not one of these, you know, one-time events.
What did you and your family know about concentration camps at that point?
Not much. Not much. We knew that they were concentration camps, but I don't remember knowing that they were extermination camps.
How did you get out of the jail?
I think we just walked out. I don't think we paid enough for this hotel, you know, so that we were evicted, and we left. And we arranged, I think again through my uncle, to be driven to a border crossing between Poland and Slovakia.
Who drove you?
A person who we paid.
And drove you in a car?
In a passenger car, up to a point where it was within a certain distance of the border. And we then were met by a Polish guide, and when we started crossing the border at night. It was very, very arduous.
Now, crossing the border, where were you?
In Poland.
Crossing into
to Slovakia.
And where in Poland at the border did you know?
I don't remember where, but it must have been someplace around Košice on a Slovak side, because that's where the borders of the two countries come together.
Do you remember what you were thinking about at this point? What was going through your head?
I wanted to live. I really, at that point I began, I was 14, 15, I was strong, and I was beginning to assume the man role in this family. So I carried the heaviest bundle, and I would help my grandmother. My grandmother was an elderly woman, and we walked, it seemed like for miles, and then we were handed off to a Slovak guide, and he took us the rest of the way into Slovakia. And we wound up in this little town called Liptovský Svatý Mikuláš, where there were still Jewish people. There was a Jewish community.
Is this where he took you, or where your family, where your uncle had told you to go?
Our uncle told us to go there, and he took us there. The Slovakia became an independent state after the Germans occupied Czechoslovakia. Slovakia broke off as an independent fascist state, which was governed by a priest. His name was Tiso. And it was a fascist state. They had black shirts. They had all of the, followed all of the guidelines of Germans, were pro-German, including the persecution of Jews, but it was done with less vehemence, at least in those days. And they had a category of a Jew which, if you could prove that you were necessary for the economic well-being of the country, they would delay your deportation. It used to be called hospodarský žid, the economic Jew. And we were there for probably 6 months, and I thoroughly enjoyed it. It's the first time I met Jewish children my age who did not go through the ghetto. They There was a little Jewish center. We used to meet almost every day and play. And I started noticing girls. It was a nice part of my life.
Were there schools there, Jewish schools?
No. The schools, as far as any, you know, systematic, established, formal activity, I did not see any of that until after the war.
Was there a synagogue?
There was a synagogue. There was a rabbi. The rabbi survived, and the rabbi married my wife and I.
What was his name?
Greenberg. I have a picture of him.
His first name, do you know?
No.
Was your family still trying to observe Jewish customs, Jewish practices?
I don't recall. Probably less.
And what were your mother and grandmother doing in this town?
Just trying to live and trying to take care of us.
Where did you live?
We rented an apartment or some rooms from a Jewish woman who I remember was a diabetic. And it's the first time I saw a person injecting herself with insulin. That's silly what stands out in your mind. But
do you remember her name?
No. No. My uncle was there with us, and it started getting to be very difficult to stay in Slovakia because the government began to become very involved between people who were Czech and people who just arrived there like us. So my uncle arranged for us to leave again and cross the border illegally to Hungary, which is what we did. A young man whose first name was Imre, he was just an incredible human being. He did it not for money, just did it because he wanted to help Jewish people. He crossed the border. He made us cross the border to Hungary.
Who did he take? You?
My mother, my grandmother, and me.
And where was your uncle?
My uncle stayed. And he actually brought us overnight. This was a long crossing. We slept at night in a forest. And he brought us to his mother's house. And we were received with the greatest hospitality. We were given a taste of normal life, a meal. We slept. My legs were by that time, and they were like. Steel, because it was really arduous. It was not a level land, level terrain.
How did your grandmother and your mother manage?
God bless her. My grandmother was a very, very strong woman. And so was my mother. But I carried most of the load. And my sister is 5 years younger than I am. And then from there we went to Budapest.
How long did you stay with Imre's family?
Just one day. Just enough to recharge our batteries a little bit.
And what were you using for money at this point?
Always exchanging gold and jewelry for local currency. That was the only thing that you could count on.
How did you carry the gold and the jewelry? Do you know?
My mother had some diamonds sewn into her sweater. It was a cardigan. And the buttons were diamonds, covered in cloth. She never let go of that card again. And gold, I don't know how he hid it, but it was hidden. He had gold coins.
Had your father left that money with your mother? Or?
Yeah, my father left money with my mother. I remember in Poland we had a strong vault at home, and I remember because my father once showed me he had a gun in there which impressed me no end. But I also noticed there was always a lot of money in there.
Was that the usual custom?
I don't know. It was a custom for us. I think my father probably hoarded some money towards the end of the war, trying to get as much liquid as possible towards the beginning of the war.
So now you and your mother and grandmother and sister are in
Budapest.
And
we are living the life of Riley. We checked into a pension. We have a beautiful apartment. We get 2 meals a day on in an area, very fine area of Budapest, within walking distance of the Danube and a parliament. As a matter of the place, the street was called Parliament Utca. And I am having a wonderful time.
Are you living as Jews at this point?
We are living as Polish Gentiles. But we befriend a Hungarian Jewish family to whom we confess that we are Jewish. And they have a son, and he and I become friends. And we roam all over Budapest.
What was that family's name?
Sepes.
Can you spell it?
S-E-P-E-S-Z.
The life of Riley.
Life of Riley. I go to, I'm going now to public swimming pools. My friend, I had never seen peppers. And my friend tells me that the way to eat peppers is to throw away the outer rind and eat the little seeds, and I am on fire. I wanted to kill him. But I see my first escalator. There was a department store in Budapest that had a wooden escalator, and I was awestricken when I saw this contraption. We're having a wonderful time. Budapest is a gorgeous city. It is totally unaffected by war. The town, the country is being governed by this regent, Horthy. There's prosperity. Jews are not being oppressed openly. I mean, there is some, you know, some discrimination, but nothing like what I came from. The city is, I remember in the morning, there would be 4 streetcars cleaning the streets, you know, driving in parallel so that the streets were spotless. It was a wonderful time of my life.
What were your mother and grandmother doing?
Enjoying it.
Was there any talk about your father?
My mother kept saying that my father is alive, and everybody kept telling her she's deluding herself. But she believed that my father was alive.
What year is this now that we're up to?
It must be 1944, end of 43. It's in the summer. It's probably the end of 43.
Were you worried that people would find out that you were Jewish?
Well, it was a constant worry, but we had adopted, you know, the mannerism, and in Hungary there was less of a likelihood of that happening. My mother is very dark. She had beautiful black hair, black eyes, dark skin, but she looked more Spanish than Jewish. She did not have any, you know, of the whatever the Germans call them, the typical Jewish characteristic. Very, very beautiful woman. So in Hungary she was perfect, because she looked very, very much Hungarian. So we were not.
Did you use your own first names?
Manek, yeah, but not the last name. We are now Polish Gentiles.
And your last name again?
Czesak. Czesak, and we find that there is a Polish camp. There is a group of Poles living in a town, in a sort of a settlement, non-Jews, and that it's a good place to go because there is some community care, and you don't have to really spend your own money, and it gives you an additional level of security. So we went to this town, which the town was called Shoah Foundation. I think that's spelled S I O-F-O-K. The town is still there, and it was on the shores of the famous lake, Lake Balaton, B-A-L-A-T-O-N. And we went there. It was a small town, and we got introduced to the man who was leading the community. He was a priest. And I think he knew that we were Jewish, but I think he decided that he was going to help us.
What was his name, do you remember?
I don't know. But I know that he took me. He told my mother to keep my sister at home. There was no reason for her. He didn't want my mother to go to church, but he said I would have to go to church. She could claim that she could not go to church because she needed to take care of my grandmother. So he actually took me and taught me how to react when a Catholic Mass is being observed, where to genuflex, where to make a sign of cross, where to say amen. He taught me that. He also, this is funny, because my mother, you asked if we were observant. At that point, obviously we were not, but my mother insisted that I fast on Yom Kippur. I did not go to synagogue. There was no synagogue to go to. But I was fasting, and I was starving. There was a Polish cultural center, and I went there to just pass the time of day, and I remember the priest coming to my mother and telling her, if you want him to fast, have him stay at home. He was eating wallpaper. I was so hungry. Everybody saw that I was starving. But they were nice. They were. I don't remember any of the people other than the priest, but they obviously protected us.
Did your mother keep a Jewish calendar?
She knew. I don't know how, but she knew. My mother was very educated in Hebrew and in Jewish, and she knew the Jewish months. And somehow or other, she knew there was Yom Kippur.
How did you feel about leaving Budapest in the life of Riley?
I was sorry. I really was sorry. I loved it. I loved that little interlude. It was very, very nice.
Do you think your mother was beginning to worry about money at that point?
I think money was beginning to be an issue. She wanted to save some and or make it last as long as possible.
So you went, how long did you stay in this little village?
Again, probably, I don't remember winter, probably as a 3 seasons, maybe 9 months.
And then what happened?
And then what happened, Horthy was deposed by the Germans. The Germans felt that he was not being aggressive enough in whatever they wanted him to do. So they deposed him and brought in a government which was much more zealous in enacting all of the persecution laws for the Jews. As you probably know, the Hungarian Jews were some of the last Jews deported to Auschwitz. And they began to systematically look for Jews. They would do this by, you know, inspecting if the men were circumcised. Circumcision in Europe is not prevalent. It was mostly Jews who were circumcised. I remember, again, the priest took me to a local Hungarian doctor, and they tried to see if there is a way that he can glue my foreskin in such a way that I would pass this inspection. And the doctor said that could not be done, probably endanger my life. Certainly would make it difficult for me to have my family. So we left again.
How did your family hear all the news about what was happening?
It was generally known.
Were there radios in this?
There were radios, and there was also the papers were pretty, and they the jungle telegraphs. This kind of life fosters jungle telegraphs. People, rumors, and news spread very, very quickly. So we knew. And we had sent word to my uncle.
Where was your uncle?
In Slovakia. And Imre showed up again. Our angel, savior. By that time, I had learned Hungarian, and I spoke Hungarian well enough so that I could travel in a uniform of Hungarian Hitler Youth called Levente, with a cap. And my mother, my sister, and my grandmother did not speak Hungarian except a few words, but I was running interference, and we traveled on a train.
Where did you get the uniform from?
The Poles gave it to me. The priest gave it to me.
Did you ever worry about the Poles in that camp turning you in, or?
Yeah, but of course you worried, but there was no alternative. The priest was, what really upsets me is that I don't remember his name, because he should have been recognized as a righteous Gentile. He was very, very a noble spirit, young man. So we took the train to a place which I guess was near the border, met Imre, and crossed back into Slovakia, back to this town, Liptovský Svatý Mikuláš. And when we got there also they began to very, very diligently seek out all the Jews for deportation. So my uncle arranged for some Slovak peasants to dig a bunker in the mountains outside a little village called Mošnica. Mosnica. And it was actually built completely into the ground. There was moss and grass growing on the roof. It was done in such a way that you could stand 10 feet from it and you wouldn't know it was there. No windows, just one entrance. And
could you stand up inside it?
You could stand up.
How big was it?
It was big, because there were maybe 10 families there. My uncle took some other people with him. And we went to those mountains.
Who took you there?
Sorry?
Who took you there to the mountains?
The peasants, the Slovak peasants, the people who built the bunker. And we went in there in early autumn and began hiding now permanently.
What year was this?
This is 44. And the peasants would come up and bring us food. We would pay them. So again, we had the rabbi was there, the rabbi from
Rabbi Greenberg.
Rabbi Greenberg, who was also a shochet. You know what a shochet is. And he would, the peasants would bring us chicken, and he would ritually slaughter the chicken. We would have kosher chicken. There was a stream, we would take water. There was a communal type kitchen. We slept on platforms, continuous platforms, and on pine twigs. There was no mattresses. It was very crowded, and we began to have tremendous shortages of everything. What happened is the peasants found it more and more difficult to feed us.
So that they were bringing less and less food
right.
to you?
Right.
We've come to the end of this tape. We were talking about life in the bunker.
Right. What would happen is the Germans knew that there were people hiding in the mountains. So they would come at night, during the day they would come to the villages that were on the foothills, in the foothills of those mountains, including the village that we were nearest to. And they would stay there for a full day, occupying the village, and they would only leave at night. They were afraid to stay there overnight. That made it very difficult for the peasants to bring food to us. So what we started doing is going down to the village at night, trying to bring the food ourselves. And the Germans also went up the center of the valley, and they burned all of the huts that were there. They had huts for hunters. They had huts that they would put hay in a winter for deer and for animals. They burned all of that. And I remember there was a man with us in the mountains. It was Reichman. And we heard shouting and we heard noise, and he thought that we were being liberated, that the Russians were walking up the valley looking for us. So by that time I was like the official scout guide, strong young man. So he said, let's go and take a look. I said, fine. And we went, and we were laying down, so we couldn't see the entire body, but I saw shoes. And he said, they're Russians, let's get up. And I said, you stay down, they're Germans. Because I saw they had the mountain hiking boots that I remembered seeing on the Germans, and they were Germans, so he would have trying to save us, he could have killed us all.
How did you get news? How did you know that Russians were advancing?
We didn't. Very little news at that time. Later on, when we started communicating with the partisan group, we had some news, which was mostly distorted, but we had some news. It was always Russians, 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 Russians.
Who went down at night into the village?
I did. We started going down in groups, three people. And then the two, we started having a severe shortage of food. And the two people who were older were too weak to go. Oh, I have to tell you one other story, my war exploit. We by that time, we had made some connection with a group of partisans who were on the adjacent mountain. There was a Russian commander, and there was a camp. There were some women, and there were some Russians, some Hungarians, some Italians, and there was, I think, one or two British pilots who were shut down. And he had a radio. He was in communication with the Soviets, and we were really, literally starving. So we kept asking for a drop of food, and they would oblige us by dropping ammunition. So we had hundreds of submachine guns and thousands of rounds of ammunition. And I remember I wound up owning a submachine gun, and he gave me one day. I started running between the two camps because it was in the winter and I knew how to ski. And he gave me, I wanted the submachine gun was very heavy. So I wanted a pistol. And he said, I can't give you a pistol because you're not strong enough to pull the trigger six times. It was a Russian version of a Colt. It was not automatic. You had to pull the trigger until it cocked and then it would fire. So I started practicing, and about maybe a month later, I pulled the trigger six times and he gave me a Colt. So I was now armed. I had a grenade. We also had no clothes. So I started wearing some of the military clothing which he had, and I also had these leggings. I don't know if you remember or if you know, the European infantry had these like ace bandages that they would wrap around their legs. It was supposed to give you some reinforcement, and it was good. So I started going down to the village, and once I remember I fell into a stream, and it was in the winter. So when I left the stream, these military pants froze. So I was walking in a pants made out of ice. I did it. And it was difficult because the ground was, again, very, very arduous, and there was a lot of snow, and you had to be careful where you stepped because you could fall into snow, and which I did once up to my neck and barely dug my way out. But I would come back to the mountain, to the bunker, always had something in my rucksack, some food. And one night we went down, there were three of us at that night, and we went to the village. Normally, as I told you before, the Germans would leave the village. But this time, two of the Germans had established some friendship with some ladies in the local tavern, and they did not leave. And we started usually in the tavern. So when we opened up the door to the tavern, there were two German soldiers with two women. They had taken their jackets off, they had shirts, and we killed them. We did not kill the women ran to the sides. That's my only time that I can say that I fired a bullet at a German, and I don't know which one of us killed him, but when we finished, they were dead. And now we had a huge problem what to do with them, because the Germans would be coming back the next day. So it was in the winter, there was snow. We got the local people to saddle up a horse-driven sled, and we cut down pine branches, huge pine branches, which we attached to the back of the sled. We put the bodies on the sled, and we took off into the mountains, and the branches would obliterate the tracks. And the village was not punished. These two soldiers were somehow or other declared AWOL or whatever it was, but nobody was killed in a village, because they would usually do that if they thought somebody was responsible for a death of a German, they would kill the entire village. So that was an interesting experience. I just recently told this to my children. I didn't say it to anybody. My mother doesn't know it.
How did that make you feel at that time? Do you remember?
It was, the firing was instinctive. I mean, there was no thought associated with it. I don't know which one of us opened fire first, but we just turned the rifles and fired. Afterwards, I did not feel bad. I did not lose any sleep over it. I was worried that there would be some severe persecution, a repercussion of the villagers, because they were our lifeline. But I was worried more about that than about the two Germans that we had helped to the other side.
You said that you had to strengthen your hand, your finger, in order to fire the pistol. How did you do that?
How did I strengthen my finger? I would attach my, this finger on any strong, like the edge of the table, and I just try to very, very hard to exercise the finger. And it worked. By that time, I have to also tell you, I was permanently starved. I used to walk around with a bone. We had some meat, and I had a bone from that meat in my mouth that I would rotate. When the war ended, I had an enormous callus on the inside of my cheek from having that bone rattle around in my mouth. We were so hungry and so weak that we would chop trees, which we needed for food, by three men standing around the tree, and we would fire these little submachine guns, 72 shots, into the tree, and the tree would fall down. We just had to be careful that we don't shoot each other. But instead of, we had no strength to chop the wood, we would shoot the tree down.
Were there ever any discussions about who would get food if it was so scarce?
No. I think it was very good. The people were very communal. Nobody hoarded. At least I don't recall. anybody hoarding. I also became the official shoemaker because everybody's shoes were falling apart, and I would fix them.
How did you do that?
I got some needles and some nails in a village, and I would make a tree stump to act like a shoe, and I would fix it. I was resourceful. I was very good with my hands, always.
Did you have other jobs at the bunker?
I carried water. I had to go down to the stream to bring water up. I was the lookout. That was it.
What did people do about sanitary facilities?
There was a latrine. And there were two. There was one for men, one for women.
How did you first establish contact with the Russian partisan camp?
I think I came across a Italian or a Hungarian soldier who was walking he started telling me that there are other people there. We would also boil. We would take the Russian machine guns had a ammunition, which was a drum, and the drum was coated in some kind of a grease to prevent it from rusting. We would take the ammunition, the little cartridge, we'd empty all the bullets, then put the casing into a pot of boiling water so that the grease would boil off, and then we put pine needles into that, and that was the soup that we drank. And that was one of the things we had. When things were plentiful, the peasants actually brought us a cow, and Rabbi Greenberg slaughtered the cow, and then he inspected the cow after, and he found that it was not kosher. He thought he had TB. So we buried the cow, and in the middle of the winter, we dug it out, and we ate it. And to the best of my knowledge, nobody of those people had gotten sick. It was hard. Those were very. I was like a rail, emaciated when these things were going on.
How did your grandmother do?
She was always very skinny. She was never feeble to the point where she needed help to get around. She was mobile on her own, and she was a strong woman. She lived till 98.
Were there babies, young children?
No. They were, I was probably the youngest.
And your sister?
And my sister, right.
Do you remember the name of the commander of the Russian camp?
I've raked my brains, and I cannot remember it. He was a huge man, mostly drunk. Whenever, but drunk, in control.
Did that camp ever give you food?
No. They gave us nothing. They wanted us at one time to go on a military action with them, and there was nobody in our camp who could do that, and that sort of soured the relationship. I stopped going there because it was very hard for me to go. It was like a 4-hour trek up and down hills in deep snow on skis, and I just couldn't do it.
Where did you get the skis from?
There was a pair of skis up there. I don't know who brought it up, but they were like boards, hickory boards. We're not talking about racing skis, you know, with leather straps for the bindings.
you remember other things about your experiences in that camp, in that bunker?
I remember how adept I became at reading signposts in a wilderness. I developed a phenomenal sense of direction, going down the mountain and coming back and finding my way, because I never walked in the open where I would leave footprints. So I always walked in the woods, but not leaving footprints was a detriment coming back, because it was hard to find your own way. And I was absolutely uncanny. I knew exactly where I had to turn, which way, and how to go to find my place back.
Did you ever get lost?
No, never got lost.
Was there a leader in your bunker?
Well, my uncle was always the leader, but no, everybody deferred to him.
Did he have to make any rules, or were there rules, regulations, meetings?
I don't remember any. My uncle, if something happened he didn't like, he would just tell the person. But I don't remember quarrels, I don't remember fights, I don't remember, people not talking to each other. We were all drawn by the same misery. So it was, we were all fairly cooperative. Some people were, there was one German family there, and of course, they always thought that they were better than the rest of the world, but no, they were very, they were not, not any really palpable tension. We were humbled by our common experiences.
When did you become aware that the Russians were advancing?
We had heard from the partisans that the Russians were making great progress, and we were counting the days, because we were told that it's going to be imminent. What we didn't know then, and found out later, that because all of a sudden the advance seemed to have stopped, that was the time that we had the Potsdam Treaty, and Roosevelt and Stalin agreed that the Russians will liberate more than the Americans. So the Russians were bringing up reinforcements, and the front sort of stopped. And we were, while all of this was going on, we were counting hours.
What happened?
I used to go down to the village. I still went down to the village. And one day I went down to the village, and the villagers told me that the Germans had, the war was over. The Germans had surrendered.
And then what happened?
I went back and I told them the good news, and no, some people didn't believe me. They thought maybe it was a trap. So we went down. This time not just me. I think two other men went down with me, and it was true. And the peasants came up into the mountain with sleds and transported some of the other people down who felt not up to walking.
Were there many who couldn't walk?
I think they all walked, but I don't think they were up to making that kind of a trip on foot.
How long did it take to get from the village to the map to your...
On foot?
Yeah.
Probably an hour and a half, maybe 2 hours. I used to leave at about 10 o'clock at night, and I'll be back at 3-4 o'clock in the morning. But that would include time spent in a village, because I would always circle the village after this experience. I would always circle the village and see if there were any lights on, because if there were lights on, I wanted to make sure that it was, that there were no Germans around.
What did you do once you knew the war was over?
I think there was some relief organization that took us to a sanatorium in Slovakia, in the mountains, in the Tatra Mountains.
Did this relief organization come to the village, or?
I think they probably came to the town. We probably worked our way to town.
Do you remember what town?
Liptovský Svatý Mikuláš, still the same. And they took us to that, to the sanatorium where we had some medical exams, and they basically gave us some nutrition, and I think we stayed there maybe 2 months and got our strength back. Then we went back to Liptovský Svatý Mikuláš and now lived in a very nice apartment. And I began to study to go back to school.
Now, had you heard from your father yet?
Nothing.
Where was money coming from now?
I think my uncle was helping us. And my mother used to get up in the morning and go to the farm and buy butter, and then she would come back and she would sell the butter to the people in town and make a few pennies that way. And she would do the same thing with eggs. She would try very hard to make some income for us. And then we moved to the cap.
Excuse me, you said you were studying, you were trying to get yourself ready
right.
to go back to school.
Right.
How did you do that?
They helped you. They realized that people who have had their education interrupted, they would lower the admission
Who's they?
Criteria. The government. The schools were nationalized. No, they were not yet. I'm talking, this is Czechoslovakia under Beneš. The Republic, the Free Republic of Czechoslovakia. Czechoslovakia and Czechoslovakia are united, and it becomes the Czechoslovak Republic. And then my uncle moved to Bratislava, which is the capital of Slovakia, and we went to Bratislava and took an apartment in a Jewish, old Jewish section. No electricity, no toilet facilities, and enormous rats. I mean, rats as big as cats. And I started studying. I remember studying with a candle because there was no light. But I managed to pass the exam, not because I was so brilliant, but because, as I told you, the admission requirements were lowered. And I enrolled at the gymnasium, the high school, in the sixth grade.
And how old were you now?
I am now 16, yeah, 17, 16.
Whose idea was it that you go back to school?
My mother's.
Was it what you wanted to
yeah.
do? What was your sister doing?
She was trying to do the same thing at 5 years lower than me. My mother did not want me to become. In those days, a lot of people turned to smuggling, to black market, to some. My mother did not want me to do that. She would, like I told you, she would get up at the crack of dawn, go and buy some butter, buy some fresh produce, and would sell it on the street to make some money for us.
What was happening to the Jewish community? Did it start?
It began to rebuild. It began to get together again. There were services again. There was a synagogue, and the rabbi had survived. He was back. There was a synagogue not far from where we lived.
In Bratislava?
In Bratislava, yeah.
How did you feel about Jewish observance at that point?
I didn't rebel. It was a way of life, and you know, it was like a part of return to normalcy. This is what we used to do before the war. Well, we're doing it now again.
So did your mother start to observe whatever Jewish practices?
Right, she tried to do that, and we slowly got back into it. Two sets of dishes, you know.
Did you start to Did you hear at all about what had happened to other Jews?
Yes, by that time we had heard.
What was that like?
It was horrible. And you begin to say to yourself, why did it happen to them and why it didn't happen to me? And that's a question that is hard to answer till today.
Did you start to look for other family members?
What happened, my mother went to Poland.
While you were still in?
In Czechoslovakia. And, well, I have to go back now. This is now 1946. It's almost a year after the war. And everybody's telling my mother, you're deluding yourself. Janek, my father, name was Jacob, but everybody called him Janek. Janek is not alive. My father, who wound up in Siberia, because when he got to Lemberg, to Lvov, the Germans and the Nazis had a pact, Stalin and Hitler, divided Poland. And the part that my father wound up in was occupied by the Russians. And the Russians passed a decree saying, if you are in the Russian-occupied part of Poland, but your family is in the German-occupied part of Poland, if you would register, we will allow you to be transferred to be reunited with your family. But my father had an incredible mistrust of the Russians, and he thought it was a trap. So he waited until somebody he knew, actually my uncle, registered, was reunited with his family, and got word back to him that this is okay. My father went to register. In the meantime, Hitler attacked Russia. And Russians, with their impeccable logic, said anybody who registered to go back to Hitler-occupied Poland is a spy, you go to Siberia instead. So they rounded him up with my grandfather, my grandmother, and my uncle, and they shipped him off to Siberia.
Your father at that point was with his...
In-laws. Right.
We've come to the end of this tape. Sternlicht, you were telling us about your mother going back?
Right. And she went to Poland. We had some property in Poland. She tried to salvage whatever we could to see if we can get some money.
She went by herself?
By herself. And not very successful. She came back. And she brought some very, very inconsequential things. And she made, I think, three trips. Now, while this is going on, my father, who never joined the Polish Communist Party in Russia, became, somehow or other, he became involved in running a bakery, which let him survive. And he saved a lot of Jewish lives. And he went from Irkutsk to Yakutsk to Tomsk. And after the war, he wound up in a town called Engels. And he, because he did not register with the Communist Party, they were making it difficult for him to leave Russia. Those who were part of the Communist Party became part of the Polish army, and they just went back to Poland. So now it's almost a year over. And my father is still in Russia. And what he did is he would write postcards to anybody that he could think the address of, telling them, I am Jakob Sternlicht, I am here, do you know where my family is? And my mother, in her rounds, I think on her third trip to Krakow, she went to an apartment house which we owned, and she was received terribly by the... I guess the caretaker, the concierge. He was terribly rude to her. And said, I cannot do anything for you, leave. Because, you know, the Poles were killing Jews after the war, which came to reclaim their properties. And as my mother was leaving, he says, by the way, there's this postcard here for you. And he handed her my father's postcard, and she fainted. She came back, she told us, your father is alive. So that's how we found him. And about 6 months later, he came back.
Was she able to write to him?
Yeah, once we had the address, we were able to write. We all wrote, and he wrote. I mean, there were letters coming every day. Now my father comes back, and
Comes back to you in
Bratislava. And I am, of course, elated. It's a tremendous thing, but I am the man of the family. And I make the decisions, and all of a sudden somebody comes here who wants to make the same decisions. And my father was not a shrinking violet. So we had some difficult times when he came back. But we solved it.
How did you solve it?
He began to understand me better. My father was the type that I know what's to be done, and your viewpoint doesn't really matter. He had an incredible consistency of, he had this idea that a man's word must never be broken. So it got to the point where if I wanted something, I would say to him, I'm going to ask you something. If you can say yes, okay. If you can't say yes, don't say anything. Because if he would say no, and I would then try to appeal and give him all the reasons, he would say, but I said no, and I cannot change my word. That's the way he was. So when he would... And he started understanding my viewpoints, where I come from, some of the things that happened to me in life, and what is important to me. And he was also a parent that never praised the child to his face. I would find out that my father thought the world of me by talking to our friends. And I would be amazed, literally amazed. My father thought this of me, because to me, he would always want me to do better or do something differently.
Did he approve of your going on with school at that point?
Yes. Yes. He did. So.
Were you beginning to learn about what had happened to all of your family?
Yes. We started trying to take inventory and found out that after the war, of the 13 before the war, after the war, there were 5.
From your?
My father's family.
And your mother's family?
My mother's family, my grandfather died in Russia. Thanks to the advanced state of Russian medicine, he died while they were trying to take out his appendix. In Siberia, but my grandmother and her son, my mother's brother, my uncle, survived and came back.
How did your father finally get out of Russia?
Official permission. He traveled to Moscow. He obtained official permissions to come back.
Was there any talk about your family returning to Krakow?
None. My father... ambition was to put as much distance between him and Russia as he possibly could. He was totally, totally apprehensive of the Russians and the Russian communists and the Russian desire to take over the rest of the world.
When did you decide to leave Czechoslovakia?
Well, what happened is the Czechoslovak Republic declared that any person who is Jewish can emigrate to Israel freely and take their possessions with them, you know, possessions in quotation marks. Because the Czech government, with a Russian blessing, supported the creation of the State of Israel, trained the Israeli Air Force, supplied them with weapons, planes, etc., hoping that the state would become a left, if not a communist state. So my father felt that we should leave. And on the way over, we stopped in Belgium, where my uncle was by that time. And my father wanted to establish a business in Israel, manufacturing paper bags, the same thing he was doing before the war. By that time, he had made some money in Slovakia. I don't know how, but God bless him. He was very resourceful. He made some money. And we had arranged to buy some used paper bag making machinery. And we arranged a contract for supply of paper to Israel from Sweden. Because you couldn't get paper in Israel. You couldn't cut down trees. Trees were being grown, not cut down. And we were ready to move on to Israel when my father had a heart attack and Count Folke Bernadotte was killed in Israel. With my father heart attack, he couldn't travel, and with the assassination of Bernadotte, the Swedes canceled the contract. They didn't want to do business in Israel. So my father became incapacitated, and in those days recovery from heart attack was very long. And again, it began, we began thinking what we will do in Israel, and he thought that I needed to learn a trade. So he, we were living in Antwerp, and the trade in Antwerp is diamonds. So there were three or four levels of skill that you could learn with diamonds, and the most expensive one and the one which would presumably give you the highest income was this cleaving of diamonds, you know, splitting the diamonds along the, which was very expensive, and I had no desire to do that, and I didn't want my father to spend the money on it. So I said, why don't we try, teach me the least expensive trade, which was the making the stone round, where you put this little chip on a, like a little mandrel, like a little sewing machine, and with a with another piece of diamond, you, the mandrel spins, and the other piece of diamond you hold on a stick under your arm, and you try to take out the irregularities so that eventually it becomes round. So you sit for 8 hours, and your movement is this. Plus, when you start learning this trade, they give you stones that are like 80 or 100 to a carat. So they are as big as a pinhead. And if you don't attach them properly to this mandrel with the wax, they pop off. So then you spend an hour on your knees looking for a pinhead. It was terrible.
Had you finished school, any kind of school in Bratislava?
I finished high school in Bratislava, and I enrolled in a medical faculty. Because every mother's dream is a Jewish doctor, and my mother wanted me to be a doctor.
What did you want?
I don't know what I wanted, but I was always more mechanically interested. I had more mechanical interests. So I said to my father, I don't want to do that. And my father said, what do you want to be? So we talked about things, and I said, I'll be an electrician. That was a good trade for Israel, so I went to Ort for a for training as an electrician. And apparently I impressed them sufficiently so that they said to my father that they would like to sponsor me in a university. And my father agreed. And I started going to the university in Brussels. I didn't speak French well enough to matriculate fully, so they gave me a hospitant status, like a visiting student. And I have some of my early notebooks here, and if I want to laugh, I read what I used to write, what I thought was French. It was terrible. But little by little, I got into speaking very good French. And while all of this was going on, our visa for America bubbled up to the top. Because in Czechoslovakia, after World War II, we had some relatives here who sent us the affidavit, you know, the affidavit of support, and we registered for a visa in the American embassy, but the quota was, you know, very, very small. And we came up to the top of the quota, and it was not possible to delay it, because I wanted to stay a little bit longer in Antwerp, Brussels. They said, if you forfeit your visa, you're gone. So we left and came to America.
The whole family.
My father recovered sufficiently by that time. He was fine. The whole family came to America on SS America, a ship of the United States Lines. It was a former Liberty ship. It was a one-class ship. So we had the run of the entire ship, but they would not let me sleep with my parents because I was too old in the same cabin. So I slept in a common dormitory with other men.
How old were you now?
18. And we came to America, and we were on a ship which originated in Bremen in Germany, and it was full of refugees from Germany who had big x-rays. Belgium, being a very technologically advanced country, had microfiche x-rays. So our x-rays were the size of a postage stamp. We arrived in New York on July the 2nd, and the inspectors did not have equipment to read our x-rays. So my first July 4th in the United States, I celebrated on Ellis Island. They took us to Ellis Island. I saw the Statue of Liberty through bars. And the following Monday, they took us to a hospital. They enlarged our x-rays and we were admitted.
Did you want to be here?
Yes.
Rather than Israel?
I didn't know much about Israel, but I spoke English by then. I had read voraciously. By the way, I read voraciously throughout the war. That's what kept my education up. I read. When the war ended, I was fluent in reading German, Czech, Slovak, and after the war, I picked up English.
Where did you get all the books?
I read Hungarian to any place I could. I read Mein Kampf because I could lay my hands on it. I taught myself to learn to read Gothic German, not only the.
Did you have any help? Any encouragement?
I don't think so. I mean, I loved reading. I still do.
And that's how you taught yourself English?
I taught myself English. I went to some classes which were terrible. It was a British gentleman who taught us or tried to teach us, and it was, you know, see, Tom, jump, you know, that kind of stuff. It was terrible.
Where was that?
In Belgium. And then I started teaching it myself. I was reading Saturday Evening Post. That was my favorite. I used to buy back issues very inexpensively. And I had developed this knowledge of America based on Saturday Evening Post.
How real was that?
In Antwerp.
No, but how real was your knowledge?
I could not understand. So I couldn't understand a culture that advertised dog food in cans. To us, cans were the height of luxury. I mean, that was the food of the gods. Anything that came in a can was better than anything you could buy because that was American, that was technology. I saw ads advertising pet food in cans. I didn't believe it. They sell dog food in cans? Plus, I remember till today, I read an ad for Carrier air conditioning. And this is the copy. Air-conditioned cows give more milk. Air-conditioned chickens lay more eggs. Think what air conditioning can do for you. I was absolutely flabbergasted. First, I didn't know what air conditioning meant. I knew what air meant. I knew what conditioning meant. I didn't know what the two of them meant. I was puzzled for months trying to understand what this ad meant. But I loved them. I loved everything I read about America. I loved.
When you got here after Ellis Island, did what you read prove to be true for you?
Yes, I think to a large extent. I mean, anything that I saw in America was better than what I left. The only things that I found very difficult to adjust to was the lack of friends. I had by that time developed a very good circle of friends in Belgium. We would always be together, and it was really a different type of friendship. We don't form close friendships in America. At least I was not able to do that. We have people whom we meet one day, and the next day when we talk of them, we say, he's my friend. It's a very easy title. In Europe, you have to earn the title of a friend. And if you are a friend, you really are a friend. You are expected, and you do act in a very unselfish way. And I used to work. I would hate Sundays. I had nothing to do Sundays.
Let's get back to what some of the history. Your family came here.
Right.
And once your x-rays were approved, what did you do?
We were picked up by the people who sponsored us and taken to their apartment in the Bronx. And we stayed there for a few weeks. My father did not want to abuse anybody's hospitality. And we had an uncle who was in Cleveland, and he offered my father to work with him. So my father went to Cleveland and tried to become part of my uncle's business, and he couldn't. So he came back to New York. We had by that time taken a small apartment in a section of the Bronx, and there was another member of the family who offered my father a position in his business. And my father was very unhappy working for other people. He couldn't. It was driving him very, very sad. As little of a problem as I had adapting to America, my father had major problems. He just could not accept that the lack of individual ability to control his own destiny. So he started thinking about starting something on his own, and he bought a business which had nothing to do with what he was doing before the war. He bought a business that was selling wool remnants back to the mills, to knitting mills. When they produce a knit fabric and when they make a sweater out of it, there are these little remnants that are left after they cut the pattern. My father would buy those, sort them by fiber, sort them by color, and send them back to the mills. What's interesting about that is that these sweaters, these fabrics involved hundreds of colors. And my father was colorblind. My mother would tell stories when he would come and say to her, "Ah, Lola, I saw this beautiful white dress." And they would go, "Look at it, the dress was red." When I was teaching him how to drive, I would tell him, when the top light is on, you can't go. When the bottom light is on, you can go. And when the light in the middle is on, you better slow down and stop. Because he couldn't tell the difference between red and green. And if you talk to a doctor, he will tell you that color blindness is incurable. My father joined that business, and within a year or two, he would talk to you about Kelly Green, about chartreuse, about peach. It was incredible. He recognized all the colors.
What did you do while your father was finding a business?
Well, what I did is, when I came here, I realized that one thing I was not prepared for is that electrical the electrical distribution in this country is totally different from the European. Not only the voltage, but everything is different. So I didn't know how much I didn't know. And since I needed to make some money, I went to work as an electrician. And I worked for about 6 months, and I learned some of the rudimentaries of the differences, and I started reading some books. And then I was able to get a job as a draftsman with Bechtel Corporation, the New York office of Bechtel Corporation. New York had opened an office, Bechtel had opened an office in New York, and they were hiring. And I think for the first time in their life, they were hiring Jews. So I got a job as a draftsman. And I'm good at drawing. I'm very mechanically oriented. And I started working for Bechtel. I worked for Bechtel 17 years.
Did you go on with your schooling?
I finished, and I took some graduate courses here. Yeah. But I did most of my work was practical, you know, just learning, not theory.
Were you living with your family at this time?
Living with my family and contributing my salary, every paycheck to my father.
And what happened with your mother and your sister and your grandmother?
My grandmother, the one that survived the war with us, went to Israel to live with another son. My mother's mother wound up in Belgium with her son and emigrated to the United States and was living with us. So we exchanged grandmothers. One went to Israel, the other one came back. So we had a grand. By that time, we were living in a nice apartment in the Bronx, and my sister went to work in an office.
And were you getting more comfortable in America?
I started making friends. We bought a car. Of course, that made a big difference in my life because I'm a car fanatic. And I was becoming more comfortable. I met some people at work. I had made some friends.
What was happening to your life as a Jew and your family's Jewish life?
My father came back with the same ideas of observance that he left with. So we joined the synagogue. My father did not like the big organized type of religion. He liked the small shtibel. So we would walk a long walk to a small synagogue in the Bronx where he was comfortable. And Saturday was a day of rest in my father's house. I smoked in those days, and I did not smoke from sunset to sunset. Saturday, my father would take an afternoon nap, and then he would go to the park. And I really think that it's a good way of life.
Did you do it too?
I didn't take a nap, but yes, but it was a big concession to my goyishkeit was that I could turn on the television. And my father would, it was a big concession. So I could watch.
Is that what your father called it, goyishkeit?
Yeah, something like that, right? Goyishkeit. And that's.
And you married?
I met Harriet at a wedding to which I didn't want to go. Because by then I became a ski instructor, and I wanted to ski on weekends. I didn't want to go to weddings on weekends, and but the man who was getting married called and wanted me to become an usher, and I couldn't say no to that, so I went to the wedding. I met Harriet, and we sat at the same table, but she sat on the other end of the table, and I like to tell jokes, I like to tell stories, and she was sitting next to a young man, and every time the music would start playing, I'd be in the middle of one of my stories, and the guy would say to Harriet, would you like to dance? And she went dancing with him. And finally I said to her one time, next time the music plays, even if I'm in the middle of a story, please wait until I finish. I'd like to dance with you.
We've come to the end of this tape.
Sternlicht. You're telling us how you met your wife.
And that's what happened. The music started playing. I finished my story. I started dancing with Harriet. She never danced with the other guy. And I said to her, I have to finish my ski instructor obligations. So the last skiing weekend is February 22nd, the Washington birthday. I will call you for a date right after Washington's birthday. And I did. And she said to me, where were you? I said, I told you. That was in February. We got married in August. She lived in the Bronx. She lived in Brooklyn. I lived in the Bronx. I couldn't take the commuting. We got married, and we chose a neutral suburb, which was Queens. Harriet at that time was teaching at Hunter College. I was working for Bechtel Corporation. And I tried to teach Harriet skiing, and she quickly decided that she would rather get pregnant. So we had our first son, Andrew.
And how many children do you have?
We have three sons, Andrew, Barry, and Russell.
And what did you, you said you worked for Bechtel for a number of years?
I worked for Bechtel for, when I married Harriet, I worked for Bechtel. As a matter of fact, I gave Harriet our engagement ring in the lobby of the building where, because I worked on a Sunday, where Bechtel, 485 Lexington Avenue. And we got married, I worked for Bechtel. We came back from our honeymoon, and I had to leave on a business trip for Bechtel. And then I decided that maybe I'd like to do something else. I was, my career with Bechtel was very predictable. I knew exactly where I was going to go. By that time, I was a senior electrical project engineer. I had all of the recognition, and it was a question of people either dying or leaving in order for me to advance. And I had become involved in a... Bechtel at that time was the project manager for intercontinental hotels that they were building for Pan Am. And they plucked me to do some of the international liaison work, translation, talking to people in Europe. And I decided I liked that. But the man who was running the electrical department wouldn't let me go. He said, the only way you leave this department is if I fire you. So I did something which he didn't think of. I quit. And I went to work for a American subsidiary of a French company, a very large French company, CGE, Compagnie Générale d'Électricité. And I liked that. I worked in Rockefeller Center, and I had a very, very nice position. And the technical liaison, traveled to Europe, did a lot of new technology investigations. Those were the times that we were leading in space exploration, and the French were very anxious to be able to find out what was going on. And electrochemical power conversion, which was my field, was one of the big, big things that they were looking into. So it was very enjoyable. I worked for about 10 years. I am a drifter. I worked there for about 10 years, and then I had an opportunity to start a company here from scratch for another French company. And I wanted to get away from the high technology and more into mass consumer products. So we started a company that started manufacturing and selling disposable flashlights. Flashlights which you don't replace the batteries, you throw away. And I became very successful. And that's what I did for 11 years. And then the French parent company got in trouble in France, and this was their most profitable subsidiary. So they sold, and the buyers would not buy unless I stayed with the firm. I had a lot of misgivings about the buyers, who were ex-French bank owners, and the only reason they wanted to buy this company here was to be able to transfer French francs out of France without having to go through the exchange controls, which this was at Mitterrand first came to power. So it became clearly, very quickly apparent that they were not interested in this business, and I left. And I became involved with a group of people that bought some companies from Westinghouse, and I helped there. I turned the last company around, traveled brutal travel. I used to go to Nashville every week. I used to leave on Monday and come back on Thursday. Every week, got to the point where I called American Airlines. The ladies knew my voice. May have been helped a little bit by my accent too, but they knew my voice. Mr. Sternlicht, how are you? And when we sold the last company, they wanted me to do something like that again for a company in Cleveland. I said, no, I did not get married. I have a good marriage. I don't want to stay away from my wife, not at this time in my life. So I was ready to retire, really. But my wife had other ideas. So 4 years ago, I had always followed her career, same as she followed my career. And the people at Smith Barney said, why don't you come and work for us?
Your wife is at Smith Barney?
Smith Barney, yeah. The present version, Smith Barney went through a dozen name changes. And I went to work for them, and I surprised the living daylights out of myself because I had to start studying again for all of the certifications. I passed them, and I'm enjoying it. I'm a financial consultant with Smith Barney, working in the same office with my wife. We leave to work together. We come home together. We don't work. We work in the same address, but not in the same office. She has her office. I have my office. We see each other two or three times during the day, but we have our own. I did not want to ride on her coattails. That's not my style, and I also want to give her full credit for her success. She's a very, very successful lady. God bless her. So I had to start my own, and it's all right. I'm having a good time.
And looking back at all the things that have happened to you and what you've told us, what do you hope that anyone watching this tape will get out of it?
I think that it's important to live a life which contributes something to the world. I think that inevitably in life things will happen that are difficult. And the difference between achieving happiness and success is to set a realistic goal and determine what is really important in life. And money is not the most important thing in life. It never was, and it never will be. And that's something we have taught our children. So you cannot guide your life by aspiring to be as wealthy as somebody else. You need to retain a sense of perspective. Don't compromise your standards, because you will have the rest of your life to regret it. And if you believe in God, not in a way of a religious observance three times a day, but in a way that will make, I like to say to my children, live your life in such a way that you can die at any time and not have to apologize for something you have done in your life. Be a person that stands for something. And I think you can overcome a lot of adversity. And I don't think anybody should look at my experience in Europe as something that they need to understand or be fully in tune with. I don't want that. First, because it's not possible. Second, because I wouldn't wish that on my worst enemy. And third, because you can say that we learn from it, and I think we do, but let's not forget that there is Holocaust going on right now. So we haven't really learned an indelible lesson. It's not something that has made us so vigilant that we would not let Bosnia or Rwanda or something that's going on right now happen again. I think it's important that you keep your goals in a proper perspective. Decide what's more important for you and be blessed with a good wife.
Do you think that your goals would have been different had there not been a Holocaust, if there had not been a Second World War?
I don't know. You know, when I used to go to Europe, back when I started traveling back to Europe, people who I know in Europe would always consider me as, you're an American, but you're really a European, because of their language and because, and they would say to me, this is in Belgium, the intelligentsia with my uncle's house, and they would chide me about America. What have you brought to the world? What is this? You know, the culture, etc., which is all wrong. The culture is here. The ancient culture is in Europe, but today the arts are thriving here. They're not thriving in Europe. There's more orchestras, more theatrical groups here than anywhere else in the world. And finally, one day this woman told me, well, what you can say is that you have brought skyscrapers to this world. Now, what is so great about skyscrapers? And I said to her, you know, I don't know, but I can tell you one thing, that the higher you go, the wider your horizon becomes. And I think, had I stayed in Europe, had I stayed in Poland, I don't know if I would have first of all, the opportunity, and then the ability to see the things that you can see living today in America. I mean, I went to Krakow back in October of this year. They still live in abject poverty. I mean, I went to the place that we lived in Krakow, in ghetto. It's a dump. It was a dump when we were there. And in all those years, it's still a dump. Now, I think that, like I told you, I think that one of the things that I am almost grateful for is that it made it possible for me to meet Harriet and to have my family here. I also have to tell you, when I went back to Poland, I have talked to people who went back to Poland and told me about a feeling that overcame them when they stepped off the plane. They felt they were returning to their roots. Nothing for me. Nothing. I looked at them like an American tourist. I saw the same hard faces. I felt the same wave of enmity. I was glad to say goodbye to them. And my sons felt the same way. So, I'm not sure, had I stayed in Europe, whether I would be as educated, as world-traveled. Maybe I would have stayed in the small, relatively small confines of, you know, Europeans. Not many Europeans travel widely.
Would you have lived your life as a Jew the same kind of way, do you think? Observing? Would your feelings about being a Jew have changed?
I can tell you that one of the goals of our life, I wanted my children to grow up being very comfortable with their Jewishness, never having to feel that because they are Jewish, they are less or they have to apologize for it. That's why they went to the day school and they grew up very comfortable with their Jewishness. I was never comfortable with my Jewishness in Europe. It was always a feeling that I remember the first time I spoke out when somebody told an anti-Semitic joke and I said I was Jewish, I felt very good, but I have listened to a lot of anti-Semitic jokes and not said I was Jewish. My children won't do that. And I think that the Jewish experience that my children had was much better than the one I had. When we moved here, there was a man living down the driveway who's never seen a Jew before he met us. He had a son who one day came to me and he said, Mr. Sternlicht, you know what Andrew called me? I said, no. What did he call you? He says, he called me a Catholic. I said, Andrew, why did you call me Catholic? He says, he called me a Jew. You know, and that's the difference. That's the difference. Now, my children are not observant. And it bothers me. It bothers me not because I want them to be observant, but I think that it's a heritage that is worth preserving, and I don't want it to be lost, which is also one of the reasons I'm making this tape.
We thank you very much for making the tape, for telling us your story.
Thank you. You're welcome.
Can you tell us about this photo?
Yes, in October of last year, we took a trip to Poland with our family. And this is the house in which my grandfather, my father's father, lived. It's part of an estate which he owned. It's in a town called Tęgoboża, which is near a town called Nowy Sącz. It's a Baroque palace. And at one time, my grandfather owned this and 1,750 hectares of land around it.
Your grandfather's name?
Moses. I am named after him. Moshe was his Hebrew name.
This picture?
This picture is again in Krakow, October 1997, on the same trip. This is the school, which was a Hebrew school at the time I attended it. It's on a street called Brzozowa, and the number is 15. It still functions as a school, but it is now a trade school.
This photo
is of a plaque on the same school building commemorating its once being a Hebrew day school.
Mm-hmm. This photo?
This is taken the same time, October 1997. This is the remaining part of the wall which circled the Krakow ghetto. What's interesting is that the Germans built the wall with these round pediments, which it was done to resemble tombstones.
Did they tell you that, or did you just know it?
No, they told me that after when I went to see it. I did not realize it at the time that I was inside the wall.
This picture?
Inside the Krakow ghetto, there is a private museum, which is in a former drugstore, which apparently was in the ghetto all through the ghetto, which was owned by a non-Jew. He was subsequently honored as a righteous Gentile. In the museum, which we had toured completely unexpectedly, there is a scroll with names of people who were in the ghetto and who were in some way active in fighting the occupation. And I walked over to the scroll and read the names. I was absolutely flabbergasted when I read my own name on it.
Do you know what they were thing you had done that made them put your name there?
I really don't. It was a total surprise. I don't remember that I have done. Maybe it's the fact that I kept going in and out of the ghetto and. Maybe that's what did it, because I cannot relate any heroic act that would put me on this list, but there I am.
You are going to give us, show us your name on this.
Yes, Sternlicht Maniac is me. The other two Sternlichts, I really don't know the names of. Obviously, they were in a ghetto and may have been related, but it was a very densely populated place.
Can you tell us about this?
This is a letter that I wrote. It's a postscript to a letter that my mother wrote and I wrote on the bottom of on November 28, 1939, to my father, who was at that time gone. And he kept it with him throughout the war, in this little purse that's on the side. And when he came back after the war, he had it and he gave it to me, and I obviously still have it. The letter says, "Dear and dearest father, how are you? I am well with my sister. Please send our kisses and love to you and our grandfather, our grandmother, and our uncle. We love you and we miss you." And I signed it.
You signed it what with what name?
Maniek Sternlicht, with a flourish.
This photo?
This is a picture of a band that we formed after the war in Antwerp. Frankly, it was a purely monetary enterprise. We needed money. We were all going to college. And we played South American music. South American music in a 49-50 was in demand. And this was our answer to Xavier Cugat.
Where did you learn to play?
I didn't play. I played. I was a singer. And I played the drums a little bit, and I also played all of the rhythms, the maracas and the claves. Yes, I think I'm holding maracas in this.
Can you identify
picture.
The people for us?
The man on the drums is a fellow by the name of Janek Polaniecki. The next to him is me, or I. I don't remember the name of the next two fellows, and the fellow with the violin is also Polaniecki. He's the brother of the fellow on the drums.
And your name again?
Mark Sternlicht.
And do you have any idea when this picture was taken?
I would suspect this picture was taken probably 1949 or 1950.
And where were you?
In Antwerp.
Where in Antwerp? Were you performing?
This was, I think, taken. We used to play at dances and at social functions. I think this was taken at a wedding.
This photo?
This photo is the picture of my wife, Harriet, and myself, wedding, August 18th, 1957. Starting from left, it's my father, Jacob Sternlicht, my mother, Lola Sternlicht, my mother's mother, my grandmother, Gitla Kellerman. The best thing that happened in my life, my wife, Harriet, myself, Mark, my sister, Selina Zborowski, and her husband, Marvin Zborowski.
This photo?
This is a picture of our family when we moved to Stanford in 1968. From left is our oldest son, Andrew. Next to him is our middle son, Barry. Next in line is myself, Mark. Then it's Russell and my wife, Harriet.
This photo?
This photo was taken at Brown when our youngest son Russell graduated, 1987. The three sons are left, from left to right, Andrew, Russell, and Barry.
All with the last name of?
Sternlicht. Very legitimate.
This was graduation from?
Brown University in Providence, Rhode Island. The person graduating was Russell, our youngest son, and he's flanked by his two brothers, Andrew on the left and Barry on the right.
This photo?
This photo is a picture of the entire family taken in this house, and it shows our daughter-in-law, starting from left, we have Mimi, and she's holding Adrian, her daughter, on her lap. Next is Barry, who is holding William on his arm, and James is sitting on his knee. Going up, it's Russell holding their dog, Lucy. Next person over is his wife, Missy, holding their son, Max. Going down, it's Andrew holding their newest born, George, and then it's his wife, Anne, holding their daughter, Alexandra, and in the middle is Harriet and Mark, myself.
When was this picture taken?
This picture was taken about 2 years ago, because the youngest are now 2 years.
1987. This photo?
This photo is of our oldest son, Andrew, and his wife, Anne, and their daughter, Alexandra, and they are holding their newly born son, George. Andrew could not be here today. He lives in Boston. Actually, he's in Orlando today. So this is our way of bringing him into this picture.
Sternlicht family, Mark Sternlicht. Mr. Sternlicht, would you like to introduce your family to us?
I would love to. On my left is Max Sternlicht, the son of Missy, and Russell Sternlicht, our youngest son. Right above me is Barry Sternlicht, our middle son, holding his oldest son, James. On his left is his wife, Mimi, holding their youngest son, William. And on my right is my love, companion, and wife, Harriet.
Nice to meet you all. Harriet, we'll let you start out. What has it meant for you to be married to a survivor?
Well, Mark has enriched my life. He's a pillar of strength. And he has shown me what has happened to people when they suffer. Some people have become richer for the experience and have an optimistic outlook on life, whereas others just become so depressed and given to it. So I think that he really has done well for himself, done well for us, done well for his family and his kids.
Who would like to speak next? Russell?
Barry?
Barry?
Yeah, I guess for me, I guess it teaches you a little bit about humanity and mankind. And my father, when we were younger, had a fairly significant temper. And as he grew up, it dissipated from him. And as I learned the story of what happened to him, you know, I understood all the frustration that he must have felt. And it certainly has taught me a little bit about compassion for fellow man and sensitivity to suffering and about being a good person and that you should honor your mother and father. Mm-hmm. And for us in this family, that has a special meaning.
You married into this family, Mimi?
Yes, I did. And my grandmother on my mother's side is actually a concentration camp survivor. And I always remember when I was a little girl, she had the number on her arm, and that was always kind of a hard thing to understand when I was little, and then she died when I was young. But I think there's always kind of a struggle back and forth between assimilation. We live in Greenwich, Connecticut. You know, we have a lot of privileges. Our kids go to very fancy private schools that probably used to be only non-Jewish. and just watching that assimilation, and kind of, I think it's the hardest thing is just kind of being cautious and always remembering that just because things appear this way, they haven't always been this way. And having a human reminder around is always kind of helpful, because you fear for your own children and the next generation when they don't have that. It's so easy to just kind of slip into the Americanness and the
Russell?
Growing up, and even today, I mean, I have a lot of friends whose parents have, you know, 6 siblings, 7 siblings, 8 siblings, and you see these extended family gatherings. One of the things that struck me as I reflect on my childhood is that my father's father, my grandfather, my grandmother never really had an extended family. I guess my grandfather lost many of his siblings during the war in camps. And I feel deprived of never getting to know the uncles and the extended cousins that I would otherwise have gotten to know. And so right now, to be honest, I'm jealous of larger families and of extended families and of these large family reunions that we're not going to have a chance to, that I've never had a chance to attend. And hopefully that, you know, all our kids, there are 6 grandkids in this family now, and one more on the way, at least right now. Hopefully we will have that. And I think what it has done is given me a sense of closeness with my siblings, and my brothers. I want to stay in touch with them. They're important to me, as are obviously my parents. And the other thing is, you know, growing up in going to Jewish day schools, going to yeshivas, there was a common bond between the kids at the school that, you know, many of our parents had shared a similar experience. And it is a heightened sensitivity, it is a heightened compassion towards your fellow man. And recently I was actually in Europe with my wife, and you still get a very eerie feeling when you see a swastika on a wall in Rome. And really, as Mimi said, you realize how lucky you are to not have been exposed to that and not to have your kids exposed to that. But it still gives a sort of that shuddering feeling that this is never over, that there is always a possibility that could be happen again, and you pray it doesn't.
Let's add one more thing. My father was somewhat unique, probably, among most individuals who went through this experience, because as we were growing up, my father did everything he could not to ever talk about it. And my grandparents would call us and say, turn on channel 13, there's a Holocaust special. And my father would walk in the room and shut it off. And I think until we recently took a trip to Poland as a family, I once asked my father, coming back from New York, I remember I must have been 13 years old, my two brothers were sleeping in the back of the car, my mother was asleep in the front. I asked my father if he ever killed anybody. And you know, I think that it was unusual that my father just kept it all inside for, I'm 37, so for 36 and a half years. I had had a glimpse into the window of his life back then, but I actually think my other brothers had no idea. I think that that's interesting. I mean, my, you know, he never wanted us to be affected by it. And it was his inner strength. It was his stamina. He's a bull, and he always has it. And he was the rock in the family. And we would go to Florida, and he'd get into an argument, and he'd get out of the car and walk along the car, and my mom would say, "Mark, get back in the car." And but this was his steam, because he had no other vent for his feelings back then. And as he's gotten older, boy, has he become a pussycat. So it's hard to, he falls apart all the time. But it's age mellows, and it's nice for us that he's decided to do this.
Annie?
It's actually very special for me. We've been married for 5 years, my husband and I, and I have to say that my first real exposure to my father-in-law's past was actually when Schindler's List came out. And I am the youngest of four children, both of my parents are first generation, and my father's father specifically was never in a camp, thank God, but has a unique and very interesting story to tell as well. I came here when he was 17 years old, and I remember hearing some of the stories through my father about my grandfather. All my grandparents passed away when I was young. And my grandfather, I remember hearing some of the stories and thinking, gosh, I really wish I had the opportunity to be a little bit older and have the opportunity to tape him. And towards the end of his life, my aunt actually tried to do that, and he actually unfortunately passed during part of this taping. And I remember distinctly when Schindler's List came out and coming home and talking, I don't know if you remember this or not, but coming home and telling them about it, and he telling me that he knew a lot of Schindler Jews, and for the first time, exposed us to a lot of his experiences. And I remember my mother-in-law saying, "I never knew that before." And for the first time, I think he had really opened up, and it was really special to me. And I remember asking my husband to say, "I don't think it's my place, but I think I'd like to ask your father, can we tape him? Because there's going to be a time where our children are going to grow up, and they're very fortunate to know their grandparents," which I really didn't, especially my mother's parents, who died very young, when I was very young. And I think it's an unbelievable opportunity for the grandchildren to know our history and our past, and what you are doing is so important, because we are losing survivors on a daily basis, and it really keeps it alive. I worked for a woman whose family was very involved in putting together the Holocaust Museum in Washington, and so I've always kind of had a little bit of it, you know, kind of in me, and I really feel honored and privileged to be part of, not only know him, but be part of a family of a man who has really, you know, just survived such things, and I find it very rewarding, and I'm glad that I was able to be a part of knowing him and knowing what he's been through.
One final thought that I have. And my dad never had a childhood. I guess from the age of 12 to 14, he was in the Kraków ghetto. And I think what it informed him as a parent, therefore, because I think each of my brothers and I, and hopefully the families I've married into, we're good kids. We're good people. No, but it is you know, we do have compassion for our fellow person. I think that I and my wife try to emulate some of the examples that my parents set in raising us. And it's important to me, as it was important to my father, that my children have their childhood. And that they don't know from what my father knew. Because, as Barry said, we didn't know, really, what my father knew. And it was conscious, it was deliberate, and, you know, he could have been this, you know, gruff old man taking it out in the world, and he never did. And I thank him for that, and I thank my mom for that, and I love you dearly for that.
Here, I'll make one other comment since we're never stopping.
Tape's still rolling.
It wasn't until we were in Poland that my father explained to us why he never took us camping when we were young. And I always wondered about that, why we didn't go out into the woods and run around like all the other kids did. And it wasn't until he told me the story that I understood. So, took a long time to find that out, but now at least it makes sense. And I'll take you camping, James.
We'll give you the final word, Mr.
Stern. Well, what I haven't actually said is that Mark is a very kind and very generous person. He is willing to give up himself continuously. If the kids need something, he'll drop everything and run over to them. He'll do everything for anybody that asks him. Not monetarily, not financially, even though he does that too, but physically. I mean, he's exhausted and he goes.
It's because of you.
It's just amazing.
Just trying to get away from you.
Do you want to add anything?
Yes.
There is not much to add. I think I have led. I'm sorry. I sound like I'm having a eulogy for myself. I was very fortunate, and I've had many misfortunes in my life. By and large, my good fortunes outweigh my misfortunes by a large, large amount. I am blessed having met my wife, having raised my family, having seen them become good human beings. People contribute to this world in many ways. We have contributed by giving birth to three wonderful young men and their families and the grandkids. And that's what it's all about.
We thank you all very much for participating in this.